2018-19, sir, cess collected was 95,081 crores. Cess released to the states was 69,275 crores. Cess accumulated in the fund, sir, zero. Now I come to the current year, sir, 2019-20. Cess collected, sir, till 31st October 2019, this year, 55,467 crores. Cess released to the states, 65,250 crores. Cess collected till 31st October 2019, 55,467 crores. Cess released to the states as of 31st October, the cess collected as of 31st October. Cess released to the states this year, 65,650. Cess released to the states in excess of the collection, therefore, is 9,783. Till 31st October 2019, sir, the Government of India has released 9,783, that amount which I just read. Till 31st October 2019, Government of India has released 9,783 crores more than the amount raised through cess collections.
And Chairman Venkaiah Naidu on Thursday announced the constitution of an ad hoc committee to deal with the challenges of regulating access of children to internet pornography. The committee has to present the report within a month. The committee headed by Jairam Ramesh will hold discussions on the alarming issue of pornography and social media and its effect on children and society as a whole with all the concerned. The committee headed by Jairam Ramesh will hold deliberations with the law enforcement agencies, TRAI, and social media giants like WhatsApp and Facebook. On 28th of November, Naidu had asked Congress MP Ramesh to form a committee comprising lawmakers from across party lines to suggest concrete steps for combating the menace. Ad hoc committees are appointed from time to time to inquire into specific subjects.
You are aware, on the 5th December 2019, I had announced in the House constitution of an informal group to study the issue of pornography on social media and its effect on children and society as a whole, comprising of the following members: Sri Jairam Ramesh, Coordinator, Sri Amar Patnaik, Sri Dr. Ami Yagnik, Ms. Dora Sen, Srimati Jaya Bachchan, Srimati Kahakashan Parvin, Sri Raju Chandrasekhar, Professor M.V. Raju Gowda, Srimati Rupa Ganguly, Sri Sanjay
and
Singh, Sri Tiruchi Siva, Srimati
Vandana
Chavan,
Srimati Pijada Satyanath, Dr. Vinay Pisantra Budde. The group has law, held a few meetings discussing the matter.
However, Sri Jairam Ramesh, the coordinator of the informal group,
questions
met me,
experienced on the financial expenditure
problems
on
being
educational
faced
reforms
and
implementation of Shala Darpan initiative in Kendra Vidyalayas.
Kriti
Mishra,
the same composition. Sri Jairam Ramesh will be the chairman of the ad hoc committee.
The terms of reference of the ad hoc committee will be under
the study the alarming issue of pornography on the social media and its effect on children and society as a whole. To hold comprehensive discussion on the subject with all the concerned, submit a report within 1 month from today. It will not be extended under any circumstances. Rules relating to select committee on bills shall apply to this ad hoc committee also.
For the farmers. HRD Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank said in the upper house on Thursday that the draft national education policy promotes a multilingualism and recommends the equal development and promotion of all Indian languages. He also said that the new education policy will be the first such policy across the world to be framed after such widespread consultations. And
अभी फसल बीमा पर जब भी चर्चा होती है तो बड़ा लोकप्रिय विषय है. सभी सांसदगण भी चर्चा करते हैं, हम लोग भी राज्य में जाते हैं तो भी चर्चा होती है. तो उस दृष्टि से हम लोग भी विचार कर रहे हैं.
HRD Minister Ramesh Pokhriyal Nishank informed the upper house during zero hour that lakhs of suggestions have been received on the proposed new education policy. The government is extensively examining suggestions and widespread consultations are being held with states for a holistic policy.
और निश्चित रूप में जो नई शिक्षा नीति आ रही है
महसूस कर रहा हूँ,
भारत केंद्रित होगी, वो भारत के ज्ञान और विज्ञान और अनुसंधान से युक्त होगी। जो ये नई शिक्षा नीति आई है संस्कार युक्त होगी, अनुभव पर आधारित होगी, परिणाम आधारित होगी, भारत केंद्रित होगी, अनुसंधान युक्त अंतर्राष्ट्रीय दृष्टिकोण को भी रखेगी, मूल्य परक होगी, उद्यमिता से युक्त होगी, कौशल युक्त होगी, रोजगार परक होगी, प्रतिस्पर्धात्मक भी होगी, सशक्त अभिव्यक्ति के गुण भी होंगे, नवाचार भी होगा, अनुसंधान भी होगा, प्रौद्योगिकी होगा। श्रीमान ये जो नई शिक्षा नीति आ रही है ये दुनिया में भारत को ज्ञान का महाशक्ति के रूप में स्थापित करेगा।
रिस्पॉन्डिंग टू अनदर क्वेश्चन, प्लानिंग मिनिस्टर राव इंद्रजीत सिंह सेड The government is undertaking measures to boost GDP growth and that demonetization did not slow down growth.
In 2012-13, in the first quarter, the growth of the economy was at 4%. And the very next year, in the first quarter, in 13-14, the economy
विशाल वैभव है, उसके बारे में विस्तार पूर्वक कहा और न केवल कहा बल्कि इस बात की भी चिंता व्यक्त की है कि यदि दुनिया के देशों में इसको लेकर के संजीदगी है, जिज्ञासा है, जिजीविषा है, वो उसको लेना चाहते हैं और अपनी पीढ़ी को देना चाहते हैं तो फिर इस देश में क्यों नहीं। इसी के लिए ये कदम सरकार ने उठाया है और ये जो तीनों जो डीम्ड विश्वविद्यालय हैं श्रीमान, ये बहुत पहले से हैं, ये इनको दर्जा दिया है अब विश्वविद्यालय का, ताकि अपने पूरे गौरव के साथ अनुसंधान कर सकें, बढ़ा सकें।
And Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman introduced the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Second Amendment Bill 2019. The bill, which aims to further amend the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, was approved by the Cabinet on Wednesday. The amendments in the law seek to remove bottlenecks and streamline the corporate insolvency resolution process. The bill was introduced amid a protest from the opposition that demanded the bill to be referred to a standing committee for scrutiny. Those were all the news related to Parliament. Let's get you some other news now. Jharkhand recorded over 62% voter turnout at the end of the third phase of elections in the 17 assembly seats across 8 districts today. Over 300 candidates, including 32 women, are in the fray in this phase. And campaigning has intensified in the state ahead of the fourth phase of elections on Monday. Prime Minister Narendra Modi addressed a rally in poll-bound Dhanbad on Thursday and allaying fears of the people of the Northeast over the Citizenship Amendment Bill. Prime Minister Modi asserted that the government would safeguard their language, culture and identity under all circumstances. He targeted the Congress Party for spreading misinformation in the region over the bill.
जो पहले से भारत का नागरिक है उनको इससे कोई लेना देना ही नहीं है, उन पर इसका कोई प्रभाव नहीं है, लेकिन झूठ बोले जा रहे हैं। भाइयों, मैंने इसी तरह की राजनीति के लिए ही कांग्रेस और उसके साथी नॉर्थ ईस्ट में भी आग लगाने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं। वहां भ्रम फैलाया जा रहा है कि बांग्लादेश से बड़ी संख्या में लोग आ जाएंगे, जबकि कानून पहले से ही भारत आ चुके शरणार्थियों की नागरिकता के लिए है। 31 दिसंबर 2014 तक जो भारत आए उन शरणार्थी को ही इस व्यवस्था का में रखा गया है। इतना ही नहीं, नॉर्थ ईस्ट के करीब करीब सभी राज्य इस कानून के दायरे से बाहर है।
Only grown at 4.2%, and thereafter in the various other quarters of these respective years, The economy grew further up to 6% even. 2008-9, the economy for the year was 3.9% growth, and 9-10, it bounced back and became 8.5% growth. So the Indian economy is resilient as such, and I don't think there is any cause for apprehension.
In reply to another question, Law Minister Ravi Shankar Prasad spoke about the use of regional languages in courts.
And the Supreme Court has developed a very good technology software whereby 9 languages can instantly be translated to the Supreme Court judgments, which includes, I would like to place it on the House, Honorable Chairman Sir, Deputy Chairman Sir, Assamese, Bengali, Hindi, Karnataka, Marathi, Odia, Tamil, Telugu,
Urdu.
The judgments can be simultaneously translated in 14 items of labor law, rent matter.
वहाँ की संस्कृति, वहाँ की भाषा को मान सम्मान देना, उसे संरक्षण देना, उसे और समृद्ध करना, ये भारतीय जनता पार्टी की प्राथमिकता है, मोदी सरकार की प्राथमिकता है.
In the name of CAP, they are misleading the people by quoting that 10 million of people, 15 million of people are going to come to take the citizenship in Assam. So this is a totally false propaganda, and I humbly request the sensible section of society in Assam not to believe this kind of misinformation.
The Supreme Court has dismissed a batch of petitions seeking review of its 9th of November Ayodhya land dispute case. The top court, which took a total of 18 review petitions for consideration in chamber, rejected them after finding no ground to entertain them. The apex court, which also considered the 9 petitions filed by third parties who were not part of the original litigation, denied them permission to file review petition in the matter as well.
Qutub Minar was commissioned by
Qutbuddin Aibak. That's it in this edition of News Tonight. Thanks for watching. Good night.
Who laid the foundation? Nearly 73 meters to 40 feet high, the star is built on the pattern of Viksitar at Ghazni. It remains to this day one of the most spectacular buildings in India, dating to medieval era. Delhi's rich history and heritage is also a story of monuments marking the beginning of eras and kingdoms. One of the oldest such monuments is Qutb Minar, which marks the establishment of Delhi Sultanate. The red sandstone minaret is divided into 5 stories, each of which has a balcony. The view from its top, now rare, Qutb Minar once overlooked by old walls and ruins spread over the vast expanse of the foundation of Delhi dynasty rule in India. Nearly 73 meters to 40 feet high, the star is built on the pattern of Viksitar.
While the construction began in 1192 AD, it remains Aibak didn't live long
enough to see the spectacular buildings in India.
The Minar was eventually completed
in 1220 by his successor Iltutmish.
Began in 1192.
Hello and welcome to Big Picture. I'm Vishal Dahiya, and today we will talk about hurdles in delivery of speedy justice in cases of rape and aggravated sexual assault. Now, less than a fortnight after the gang rape and murder of a veterinary doctor in Hyderabad, the Andhra Pradesh cabinet has approved a bill which proposes death penalty in cases of sexual abuse of women. It also seeks completion of the entire trial along with judgment within 21 days of filing of the FIR. At present, there is no provision for death penalty in Indian laws for rape convicts. However, Criminal Law Amendment Act 2018 and amendments to the POXO Act provides for death penalty as a possible punishment for aggravated sexual assault on children below the age of 18 years. Now, the real
Hello
issue
and welcome to Big Picture. I'm Vishal
Dahiya,
and today we will talk about hurdles in delivery of speedy justice
in cases of rape.
So, what are the hurdles in delivery of speedy justice to the victims,
the gang rape and murder of these hurdles in Hyderabad?
For more on this, the Andhra Pradesh cabinet has approved a bill
which proposes death penalty.
Sunita Ahuja, advocate,
sexual
Supreme Court. We also have with us Mr. Satya Prakash, the legal editor of the Tribune, and we also joined by Justice S.N. Dhingra, former judge of the Delhi High Court. Welcome all of you to Rajya Sabha TV studios. Let me first begin with you, Satya, and let's look at the, you know, tipping point here. That's the decision taken by the Andhra Pradesh cabinet to enact such a law. One more stringent law added to the list.
Well, it's a knee-jerk reaction. We all remember what happened in 2012. December 16 gang rape case, and thereafter in 2013 there was amendment in criminal law, and rape laws have been made much more stringent. In 2012 we had POXO that was made much more stringent. So it's this entire question of dealing with the issue of rapes and punishing the guilty with much more stringent laws, I don't think it's going to work. Why? Because it's not per se about law, not that we didn't have laws.
Mm-hmm.
We did have laws. The problem is about implementation and timely delivery of justice. So how you can ensure timely delivery of justice? Primarily, there is a complete mismatch between the number of crimes which the court system is asked to handle, mm-hmm. and the human resource that they have in terms of judges, in terms of paralegal staff, and also the infrastructure. Unless that part is handled properly and the problem is addressed on the on the front of human resource, I am talking about the number of judges, I don't think, even if you put that 21 days deadline,
mm-hmm.
it's not going to happen. One. Second is, I find it unrealistic. In 21 days, you complete everything. It's unrealistic because you presume that the system will be functioning with utmost efficiency, which is not the case in most of the states. So the system should it should be reasonable, and then you take into account the way it actually functions, not that you it's a sort of utopian idea that everything will be done in such a manner that outcome is there within 21 days, because you have investigation, you have sometimes even forensic reports, they don't come in time. So and there is much of the delay is because of the delay in getting the forensic report, and in such cases,
mm-hmm.
I'm talking about rape cases, forensic reports are very important. So I don't think it's a very sane idea, because unnecessarily you are enacting laws which cannot be implemented.
Mm-hmm.
So you should be slightly reasonable while enacting laws. You should take into account the ground situation, the kind of prosecutors you have, the kind of the police investigators you have, and the kind of court system which will deliver the verdict.
The entire justice delivery system.
Yes. So, to me, we have enacted a law, or the Andhra Pradesh cabinet has approved a law which is not has not taken into account the ground situation.
Okay. Ms. Ahuja, if you look at this particular law specifically and start from there, you know, the intent seems to be very noble out here, to try and go ahead and ensure that justice is delivered to the victims in a speedy manner, as soon as it can be. But as Satya is pointing out, you know, the way our justice system is, and in fact, there are several studies. One of them is from a committee which was set up by Delhi High Court only after the 2012 Nirbhaya case. And it clearly points out that, you know, even the deposition of the rape victim does not take place within the 60 days, which is the stipulated time.
When we talk about, Mr. Dahiya, when we're talking about delay, we have to be looking at delays at multiple levels. One, delay at investigation, delay in trial, delay at the time of disposal of appeals. Now, to say that having a law have a, for a time-bound investigation, then time-bound trial and time-bound disposal, mm-hmm. is basically, you see, there are, as Mr. Satya pointed out, we already have laws. In POXO, there are time limits. In CRPC, there are time limits. The issue is, why are those time limits not being adhered to?
Yes.
So if we have too many laws, and which can be easily sidestepped, saying that, you know, there are not enough people to man the courts, there are not enough resources, so therefore we are ultimately reducing the authority of law. So we are getting comfortable with the fact that you have a law which need not be implemented. So in my opinion, having a immediate, in, as a knee-jerk reaction, what sir pointed out, and enacting a law with a full knowledge that the law is not going to be implemented, ultimately is not going to serve the purpose, or even the noble purpose, noble intent which you pointed out. So therefore, a multiplicity of law, mm-hmm. is actually adding to the reducing the validity of law, authority of law. Secondly, we are not looking at creating the infrastructure. The difficulties, as far every outgoing Chief Justice of India has pointed out in their speech, the problem is about how the court, the vacancy at the lower court levels. That is a larger issue. The infrastructure is a larger issue. That without having the investment in the infrastructure, without investing in the people who are manning those, the courts which are going to conduct these day-to-day trials, how mm-hmm. do we implement it? You know, a simple thing, for example, a judge is on leave today. In the case which is listed in a criminal court, will get adjourned, and I'm on a conservative side, by 4 months. Mm-hmm. And on a non-conservative, on a real practical side, it gets adjourned by almost a year. You know, even from August 2019, the dates were given for next year, July 2020. So one day, if the court is on leave, just imagine for that one court, the matter has been delayed for 1 year, right? So those are the practical difficulties as far as the trial is concerned. Now, you are saying the 21 days. 21 days is not really, it's not just unrealistic, it is a mockery of the criminal trial itself. Because, you know, when the criminal trial starts, once the investigation is over, IU submits all the documents, when the criminal trial starts, there are so many stages when you are confronting people with documents, that you are examining them with the help of the memory. So there is a huge amount of jurisprudence behind all that happens. How do you do this in 21 days? Mm-hmm. You see, it is the purpose of criminal justice system is not to catch hold of people and hang them, okay. or to punish them, but to do justice. And when we talk about justice, you know, as a lawyer, we appear both for the accused as well as complainants. So justice is not just in terms of giving immediate verdict, but giving just verdicts. So therefore, in a case where there are, for example, in a gang rape case, for example, there are multiple witnesses, how do you examine them? Mm-hmm. And how can you examine, a lawyer is expected to examine one witness, or a judge is expected to pay that sort of an attention, more than two witnesses in one day, you tell me. Mm-hmm. It is impossible. You know, we do it, you know, because once you say that it has to be in a little, but ultimately, who will be the sufferer? The justice will be the sufferer.
Okay. The 21 days might seem like, you know, very less time, as you're pointing out, you know, of the entire process as well. But one argument which is given is that why can't the process be prioritized if it's weighing so heavily on the conscience of the entire nation? And if these kind of cases, why can't they be put on priority? And yes, there are fast track courts which the government has said it needs to be set up. Some of them have been set up, and the some of the cases have been tried there as well, and the verdict given there.
See, now that is about the trial. You're saying that yes, in 20 or whatever, 6 months or 8 months period, you know, if an effective investigation, that itself sometimes may take about, you know, 3 to 4 months. Mm-hmm. It is not that, you know, everything can be done. For example, what sir pointed out, FSL report. Nowadays, the mobiles, the data, cyber data, digital data has become such important evidence. Now, all that has to be matched. Just you're putting your 65B evidence. So all... And these all takes time. For example, if 65, you see, if the mobile has to go, if somebody has made taken a clip or made a video out of it, so that has to be examined. These are complicated processes. It cannot be just done in 2 months, 3 months, 6 months. Why? Okay. What I'm saying is the idea has to be, we have to create infrastructure. We have to create infrastructure and things will fasten. And one, of course, the sensitivity and commitment.
Okay.
That is something which is lacking. So we're not, instead of just looking at the law,
okay,
can we look at those also?
Okay. Let me bring in Justice S.N. Dhingra here. Justice Dhingra, one simple question that I have for you is, what are the hurdles, according to you, in terms of ensuring speedy delivery of justice to the victims of rape and aggravated sexual assault? And how can we go ahead and, remove those hurdles? There are quite a number of them pointed out by Satya and Ms. Oja out here. But from your perspective.
See, the biggest hurdle which I find is intention. See, the state legislature here has intention to throw dust into the eyes of the people by saying that we have enacted a law that within 21 days the trial will be over. I do not know whether they have made a provision that if within 21 days trial is not completed, who will be hanged? Whether the judge, the IO, or who will be hanged?
Mm-hmm.
Then you complete the trial. Is that, the process, criminal process is over. After trial, the matter goes to High Court. What time limit has been fixed by this legislation for the High Court? Has it fixed that High Court will decide the case within 1 month?
Mm-hmm.
And if the High Court fails to decide within 1 month, the judge will be hanged? Or what time limit has been fixed for Supreme Court? That if the appeal is taken to Supreme Court, how much time Supreme Court will take, and if it is not done, what will happen to the judge? You see, these are just gimmicks being played by the legislature to divert attention that look how sincere we are. For last 70 years, since we have gained independence, mm-hmm. criminal justice system is suffering from inertia. We have not been able to bring a single meaningful change by which justice can be given, delivered in a proper, orderly manner even. You see, where the parliament or the legislature pass law, then they forget what happened to the law. How the law was twisted, diverted, misinterpreted by the courts, and then they forget, they even don't bother. What happened to the law which they have passed? Why wrong interpretations have been given? How it should be set right? A few days back, I heard Chief Justice saying that our judicial system is very good. It doesn't need much of the change. If the judicial system is very good, a trial takes place in 30 to 50 years in normal course.
Mm-hmm.
People remain in jail for 12 years and then they are declared that you have done no crime. This is the judicial system which we have.
Okay.
You have pinpointed rape cases. Today, press is drumming one rape case or the second rape case. Tomorrow there may be a maverick who may kill school children. Go to a school and kill school children as it happens in America.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll say, oh, murder is also equally grievous. The offense, it is very heinous offense. We should make a law, similar law of quick trial about murder. Then you will find ransom cases where children are taken on ransom. And you see, there are people who will say, unless you give so much ransom money.
So Justice Dhingra, what you're pointing out here is the lack of infrastructure. Is that what you're saying?
Then, what I am pointing out that you cannot make a separate law offense-wise. You must reform the whole judicial system, that the judicial system should respond to each and every offense in a quick, in a reasonable time. It should respond and the result should be there.
Okay, but one more question. One more question, Justice Dhingra, here is, you're pointing towards the legislative in terms of, you know, the kind of laws they make and all that. But if you look at the entire justice system, the responsibility is a shared one out here between the legislature and the judiciary. So it has to be, the effort has to be made from both sides, hasn't it to be?
This is what I'm saying. You see, this is what I'm saying. The lack of intention. Not only on the part of judiciary, legislature, but on the part of prosecution, on the part of judiciary. Have you seen a special criminal bench working round the clock in Supreme Court or in High Court? They keep hearing Ayodhya case for 1 month. Ask them to continuously hear appeals, rape appeals for 1 month. Then they will be able to dispose of 20 rape appeals, 20 or 30. See, but rape is not a priority. Why they have not fixed that rape cases or criminal cases will be a priority? You have special commercial bench in High Court. You don't have a special criminal bench in High Court.
Okay.
See, the intention is just to, you see, whenever there is something happens, issue a statement that, is something very wrong.
Okay, Justice Dhingra, I get your sentiments here and I get your point here. Let me bring Satya here. I'll come back to you, Justice Dhingra. Satya, looks like, you know, the entire situation boils down to that basic question which you started with and which Ms. Oja also pointed out. Does everything else, settles down to the question of having proper infrastructure in place to ensure that the both the investigation, the trial, and the entire process is done in the due course of time, as is mandated by the laws which are enacted by the legislature?
No, apart from the human resource, the number of judges and the paralegal staff plus resources, what Justice Dhingra has pointed out, intention. Intention on the part of the legislature, executive, and also on the part of the judiciary.
Mm-hmm.
Because as Justice Dhingra has pointed out, you don't find special criminal benches in Supreme Court or High Court. And that is why many criminal cases, in fact, in many cases, murder cases particularly, it takes almost a decade for an appeal to be taken up in the High Court. Justice Dhingra might correct me if I am wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But why? Because of the priorities they fix. You have special benches, commercial benches, but not special criminal benches. But having said that, there are cases in which trials have been completed within a week or 10 days and 15 days.
Mm-hmm.
Those are exceptional cases. That cannot be the rule. Exceptional cases, I am saying, there could be a case where you have all the evidence which is available. You have eyewitnesses, maybe you have forensic evidence which is collected, and then you get very quickly the FSL report and all. So this can happen in some cases, exceptional cases, where the system is working perfectly well, but it cannot be the rule. So the legislature, while enacting laws, or the executive, while proposing the law, they should take into account the realistic situation on the ground.
Okay.
They should not, because there seems to be an attempt, because there is an incident in Hyderabad, which was earlier part of the undivided Andhra Pradesh.
Mm-hmm.
So, fearing that there could be some backlash or people might react angrily to such situations.